everybody. Welcome to another episode of Flashback 64, the chronological Nintendo 64 podcast. I am Gooey, joined by McKenna.
Hello.
As always. And we are, well, first of all, we have fantastic, wonderful returning guest, Ryan. How's it going, buddy?
Hey, guys. How are you doing? So, I understand you're here to talk about the Nintendo 64.
Are you going to, like, kidnap us or infiltrate the podcast? Oh, you kind of have, actually.
Kind of, yeah.
It's great to have you back.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Yeah. We also have a brand new guest. We are also joined by our pal and one of our patrons, actually, Matt. Hello. All the way from Australia. How's it going?
Yeah, good, thanks. How are you?
Great, yeah. Thank you for taking time out of the middle of the day to come and join us this evening and talk about some fine tapes.
No worries. Joining from the future. Yep, it's fun.
One thing we like to do, you know, with all our guests for their first time is to kind of get the vibe of, like, what you were up to at the time of the, you know, the heyday of the N64, and I guess what your experience with it was. Is there, you know, were you like paying attention at the time? What was it like, I guess, in, you know, the Australian launch? I know we're all on, like, different timelines at this sort of time, but, you know, what was your experience like?
Yeah, so I was, so I'm born in 92, so I would have been, what, like six when it came out. So, you know, I think I just remember, like, mostly hype, you know, and friends getting them and, you know, me not having one, which was, you know, very painful. But one day, so I had a PC growing up. I didn't have a console until I was a bit older. But one day I get home from, I don't know, I assume primary school, and Dad's like, come in here, have a look at this. And he's got Ultra HLE, which was, like, one of the very early N64 emulators, up and running on his PC. And he's like, yep. And there's Zelda, there's Ocarina of Time running on the PC in, like, I think it was like 1999 or 2000. It was very early days. And that was my, that was my first experience actually playing properly N64 games on a, you know, probably like a Pentium 3 Voodoo Banshee graphics card PC in late 90s. So I can't say that that's typical for all Australians, but that was how I did it. And this has been the days before, you know, good third-party controllers for PC as well. So I'm using, like, the mouse, not mouse, just keyboard, and I'm trying to, like, spin Bowser in Mario 64 using, like, the arrow keys. It's highly not ideal.
Wow, yeah. No, yeah. That, I feel like that is kind of unique to have, I don't know. My parents weren't, like, adept like that technologically or anything, so...
Yeah,
that's really cool, I think, honestly.
Yeah, look, it's different, but Dad was all super into that, and now me also,
I know. Yeah, I noticed, like, some of the comments and questions you've sent to us have asked us about all the stuff that I'm like, I don't know anything about this, so I hope to, you know, learn more about. Well, we got the EverDrive, but we still haven't stuff yet, so. We're just getting into that sort of world of, like checking out ROM hacks and things like that. So that'll be fun.
Oh, it's awesome. Yeah.
Okay. Before we get started, can I ask a very specific Australian Nintendo 64 question?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. So in the States, we had this game, Beetle Adventure Racing. Are you familiar with this game? Have you heard of it?
I can't say that I have off the top of my head.
Okay.
It's possible we had it here, but...
Okay, because apparently in Australia, it's not Beatles. It's, like, some other car brand that's, like, very Australian.
Is it Hot Wheels?
It's not Hot Wheels. It's, like, a real car brand.
Oh, okay.
Ooh. I don't know.
I might have to Google it.
Hot Australian car brands.
I was going to say, we used to have Holden, but that's, they're gone now. Nothing's made here anymore.
Do we need to do, I think we need to go and figure this out now. Actually,
yeah, let's hit up Google. Let's.
we didn't come here to talk about Beetle Adventure Racing.
Beetle Adventure Racing.
HSV Adventure Racing.
Oh, HSV. Yeah, that's Holden. Yeah.
There we go. Okay.
Oh. Yeah.
Okay. Good.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Wow. Okay. Yeah. So yeah, we used to manufacture Holden in Australia up until the last factory only closed like maybe like 5 years ago. Yeah.
So do they have like such power that they could come into this? It's an EA game, it looks like, and and say like, hey, no, you got to put our cars in it. They had that power.
I really wouldn't have thought so, but here we are.
I guess Beetles. Don't you know the Volkswagen Beetle doesn't really feel like a very powerful vehicle.
No, but
either,
we have them here. Like they could have just released it; it would have been fine. Like everyone knows what a Volkswagen Beetle is. Like, yeah.
Okay, there must be some like backstory to that. We'll have to have you on.
Table this for like 6 years when you get to 1999.
I think this is the lineup for that episode. All right.
Yeah. All right. I'll be back.
I'm thinking of getting a tattoo of Luigi on my left butt cheek.
I gotta thank you, Ryan, for kind of. Well, you're sort of the reason we. Talked about doing this episode. You reached out to us and you were like, "You're gonna cover the Nintendo VHS tapes, right?" And it turns out you collect these. Is that something like, are those things you've had like since then or really?
Yeah. Okay. These are things that were mailed to me. They came into a mailbox. These VHS tapes, and for your younger listeners, I cannot even explain what that was like. Most of the ones I have are original ones that I've had since I was a kid and got them in the mail. But I bought on eBay more recently in the last like few years, but. Yeah,
it's very cool, and like we found them. There's one like I'll put a link, but there's like a YouTube channel where someone kind of like uploaded them all, which I really appreciate. I didn't have these any of these at the time. I didn't have like a Nintendo Power subscription, but I did. You know, it did make me kind of nostalgic because there's plenty of like random promotional material I got that was like just a unique physical object. Like I remember actually in the hype to the GameCube, you know, getting a disc that I put in my computer and it had all these like videos, you know, and you know, you'd get demo discs and things like that, and there is something like, there's kind of like a nostalgic tactile feeling to like,
yeah,
actually having these, and that's so cool. You still like have held on to them.
Did you guys used to get things in like cereal boxes? Like, you know, we'd get like a disc in there and it'd be like Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 2. And you'd be like, yep, sweet. All right.
Yeah. This is not the same thing, but, I used to have some game that came with, one of the Captain Crunch. You remember those like little crazy Captain Crunch like monsters they had? Like I think it was Captain Crunch, and there was like a box of Captain Crunch that came with like a whole game like starring them, and I went kind of crazy for it because I loved Captain Crunch and I thought these monsters were like, I don't know, they were trying to like be like, they reminded me of like Taz, you know, just like this crazy like, you know, gnarly creature. So it appealed to me as a kid for sure, but I never got like a real game that I was like stoked about. I usually like, I've gotten demo discs and things like that, but I never got like, there was one for like Tony Hawk where it was like you play like the first level, right? The warehouse level.
I thought it was the full game, but this might be my, you know, child brain misremembering, but I seem to remember we got the full. I remember Age of Empires and Tony Hawk 2.
Oh,
but came in Nutri-Grain. I don't know if you guys have Nutri-Grain there, but yeah,
that's not the cereal I would expect it to come in.
I don't know. It kind of tracks for Age of Empires, I think.
Yeah, I agree, and I mean I love that game, but I agree for sure. There is something like, you're right about like It could have been Tony Hawk. It could have been the whole game. As a kid, it really felt like, you know, whatever you would get. Just like I got this crappy Captain Crunch game, and it was just like blew my mind, you know. So
yeah,
but yeah, these are awesome. Ryan, you said, like, I don't know how to explain this. I feel like the best way to explain these is that it's like instead of getting a Nintendo Direct, like, you would get a Nintendo Direct mailed to you.
Yeah. Essentially. Yeah, like, especially, like, the sillier Nintendo Directs. Like, the kind of, like, Iwata era, where they'd have, like, these skits, you know, like, the... like the Star Fox puppets and the, you know, non-specific action figure, if you remember that from like the Wii U and like those. And that's kind of like what these are. Like, we're going to go into them, but they are utterly ridiculous. And they're like here to sell you a game, and like there's game footage and stuff, but they're also like these like miniature B movies at the same time.
I really appreciate that. Like, even like at the most like corny some of them get, I'm like, well, if it feels like there's some effort put behind this, you know.
And it's like they're all kind of like winking at the camera, sort of. There's like some self-awareness, but then also not at times. But
that's what's interesting about them, is they all take this tone of, this was in that so there's three videos we're talking about, and the first one was actually the earliest one that you had sent was from 1995, so before the Nintendo 64 had released. This, I think the video is called Invasion of Nintendo.
Welcome, gentlemen. Your assignment is simple. Infiltrate Nintendo's secret research and development laboratories and bring back some critical information. If you fail, I assure you it won't be a pretty sight. I will be forced to remove a vital appendage.
It's in that era where they were doing the Play It Loud marketing. So, like, they were trying to compete as, like we're edgy and cool, too. But then it's got this weird tonal thing where then it's like they're also being sarcastic. We know we're being edgy, we're being sarcastic about it, but also we're showing you Yoshi's Island, which is just such a strange, like, tonal, you know, comparison, those three things. You have Yoshi's Island going on, and Bush is playing in the background.
Oh, man, these soundtracks.
I was blown away. Like, I started, like, I was like, there's no doubt, and the Toadies are on there, which are both bands that I love. But then there's a bunch I didn't even, like, I don't even remember. But I was like, I would love, I wanted to sit down. I didn't have time, but I'm totally going to sit down and make, like, a playlist that has, like, all these songs on it. It captures, like, such a perfect time.
Then in the Star Fox video, you've got, like, real, like, it's almost Nirvana, but not quite. Like, they've clearly been like, make Nirvana, but make it look like I didn't copy your homework kind of thing. It's really funny,
like,
that one.
It's like DDP's theme in WCW that sounds like we just reversed the notes a couple ways. Yeah.
Yeah, I had not watched the Star Fox one in probably like, or I think it was the Star, no, it was the Change the System. Like, I hadn't, like, I'd watched, put it on, like, recently to, like, capture some clips from, but I hadn't, like, really watched it, like, all the way through. And I got to the end, and I'm like, okay, I'll just, like, watch the credits and stuff. And then I see, like, produced by Bob Mould on, like, one of the songs.
I was like, whoa!
like, oh, I know who that is now. I did not, you know, in 1996 or whatever.
Yeah, that was, I remember that too. This is again more in that, like, slightly previous era, but I remember in Council Wars, both the book and the documentary, they also bring this up, like, the bands Nintendo got to play some event, and it's like they had, like, the Butthole Surfers playing an event, and it's like, well, that's such a, like, it's not, like, the most niche band, but that's, like, kind of a, like, a very specific choice. It still feels actually kind of cool that they did that. But what did you think about, because we've talked about on our show, like, it's like some of this is like advertising from like right before you were born. Like, did it speak to you at all? Did you grow up with this era of like marketing, like, at all in your memory? Where everything's like, yeah, like old people are rude.
Like, vaguely, yeah.
Okay.
yeah. Especially just like the cheesy, like, villain like guys who are, you know, sneaking in. That feels very.
That was like every single video had that element to it. Well, not the change the system was more like lighthearted, but like, I love that. Like, Nintendo has like a, they have like a persecution complex, it seems.
Yeah,
like
the other two go pretty hard.
Yeah, I was actually kind of surprised by in the Star Fox one where they like legit had the guys with the Sony and Sega shirts. Like,
yeah, it's quite on the nose. Like, I don't know if you could get away with that. Like, I guess, you know, yeah, I guess it's going direct to people these days. You couldn't do it, right?
No.
Yeah, would it be like, because like, would Sony and Sega be upset, or would like everyone, you think everyone else would probably think of it as like in poor taste too, don't you think?
Yeah, I would think it would just be more that Sony and Sega would just litigate. I don't know. I don't know if you can over that, but I'm not a lawyer, but yeah, it just seems like just, I don't know, a product of the time.
I would feel like just personally, I'd be like, okay, Nintendo, like, you're not like, like, even at this time, it's like, you're not some like scrappy, you know, underdog fight mm-hmm. like playing mm-hmm. it loud, fighting the system, you know. Mm-hmm. I like almost like their directs like almost couldn't be like, it would almost be annoying if they tried to make an edgy Yoshi direct again, you know. It just feel like, you know, just like Yoshi could be cute, it's fine, you know. There is something though that kind of appealed to me about, like, I think it was in the, was it in the Nintendo, the Invasion of Nintendo? That's where they had like the different skits with like the old people who are like,
yeah,
just like way too into the games or saying something like mm-hmm. vaguely crass about certain things. Like, there is something that's like kind of nostalgic about that. But yeah, it's like, I wouldn't expect Nintendo to go that way ever again.
Not.
Yeah, I don't think any of the major companies will ever do that again. And like, and I don't mean this in like a like return way or anything, because like, I don't know, like, this stuff like also isn't great in a lot of ways, but like, I feel like there's just like this level of like decorum and just like corporatism in like the game industry now, where it's like, oh, we're all gamers. I wish the best for our competition who aren't actually competition. We will never actually mention them. That's why I think like stuff like when a bunch of like the Microsoft stuff kind of like leaked during like the hearings about the monopoly and all that with the Activision acquisition, and there were like those emails from like Sony people being like, we don't see Game Pass as a threat, and like, and all this kind of stuff that like these companies like never say because they don't like really acknowledge each other like mm-hmm. by name or anything. But like back in this era, like it was pretty overt.
Yeah, they were like, you almost had to like call them. It makes me think of like pro wrestling a little bit. It's like, yeah, you gotta like do a promo on the other company or something, you know.
Totally, that's what E3 used to be like in the heyday, like in the like late 90s, early 2000s. Like,
yeah,
they were just dropping bombs on stage.
The last
like bombs 24/7.
The last time we got something like that at E3, I feel like, was actually kind of mild. It was like the one with the last like console generation, where like, you know, they were like, oh, you can lend your game to your friend. Wasn't that the big move they did? I don't even remember the specifics, right? It was like,
yeah,
Sony, right, did that?
Yeah.
Xbox was not going to allow, yeah.
And it was like sharing. It's like kind of it was like kind of a mild dunk, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Compared to like using the competition's name in your marketing slogans, you know, like Nintendon't and all that stuff.
Yeah.
I don't know. Do you want that to you want that kind of marketing to come back?
No.
No, that's not your vibe.
It's like you still. It's like when you you still see people sometimes doing the console wars thing online, mm-hmm. and it's like, really?
Yeah.
You're
yeah.
still doing
yeah,
that.
Yeah, it's like just it's play, like fighting a war that's ended bridge. So long ago. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Jago rules.
Riptor rules.
Jago rules.
Jago sucks big time.
You suck.
Yeah, let's talk about some of this invasion of Nintendo. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to mention with the parts like of the, you know, the edgy old people like cracking wise and stuff. I was thinking of that, like what I liked about like the this kind of shows some effort in that, like in those little vignettes, like they actually like looked kind of cool. Like they shot them, like they kind of looked like a music video or something like that. Just some of the,
yeah,
some of the like sets and shots they did. And I was like, I don't know. I kind of just like there's something behind it. They put some effort in there, but
I do think it's important to mention the Donkey Kong Country Exposed video was the first VHS that Nintendo Power sent out. And that like really established what you were just talking about, that sort of house style for these videos. Like you've got the, you know, like those gross like piss filters that were in like every like grunge and industrial like music video of the era, and then you know, everything just looks like an Alice in Chains video, and yes. then you also every person talks like Jeff Spicoli in yeah. Fast Times at Ridgemont High. Like that is just like you have like five dudes in every video who are just like ultimate dudes.
And again, it's funny because they're usually playing like a Nintendo game, which yeah. is like cute. Like in one of them, yeah. they're playing Mario 64, and they're like, "Yeah, get Bowser!" Oh, yeah. It's like, okay, calm down, guys. Like we're swinging a turtle around by the tail. It's yeah. not that intense.
And then shaky cam. There's so much shaky cam in these. Angle. They are everything Dutch is angles. Blair Witch Project. Yes, like
and like yeah. freeze frame slow mo where it's like one frame a second. Like what? Who thought that looked good?
That well, you also just reminded me in the some of the Nintendo powers we've read from around the time we're at now in the show. There's these. What? How about the Star Fox advertisements? Yeah. A lot of advertisements are like this.
What's it?
It's like, oh, there's a puke bag.
Yeah,
they're of like mm-hmm. an airplane, you know, vomit bag or whatever.
Yeah, it's like telling you to pick up these guides so you won't have that queasy feeling.
They're like, our game like, will make you
vomit.
You're
gonna get sick from playing. Unless you look at our guide.
That's like, it could be like, wow. No matter what game it is, it could be like Kirby or something, and they're like, you're gonna shit your pants. Like, okay. So both the invasion of Nintendo and Change the System videos feature like the same three guys like from Nintendo. Mm-hmm. I recognized Ken Lobb because I, you know, mm-hmm. hear his name brought up, especially like with the whole GoldenEye connection. That's like kind of one of the mm-hmm. one of the best fun facts about GoldenEye. But the other guys, Henry and Armand, were also in both the videos, and those are personalities that I'm like less familiar with, I guess. Like, I guess Ryan, you probably have more familiarity because you watched these at the time. Are those guys like you recall seeing in like a bunch of videos, or they're just like, are they play test? Like they say they're game testers, right?
Yeah. I mean, so those two don't particularly ring any bells, but like there are a few people that they kind of like bring out like, in a few of these videos, Dan Osen, who's like, He's like a long time Nintendo guy. I think he's in the Donkey Kong Country video. And so what's interesting, again, going back to Donkey Kong Country video, that is the first like real public introduction to the treehouse, because that's where it was like sort of established. Like, we have this like cool place for making and testing Donkey Kong Country, because it's like the killer app. And and then like over time that just becomes Nintendo of America's like localization center and like kind of like PR vehicle. And like, it's these videos, like there is like a really clear through line from like these videos to like something like Treehouse Live and Nintendo Directs,
right?
Which is just like pretty interesting.
I was thinking about that, like I wonder if there are people who think of like some of these people who are in these videos like as fondly as like some people treat, you know, certain, like, even like I guess like Reggie is kind of one of the pinnacle ones, because he was like, you know, one of the top guys. But like, you know, people who would show up and like basically market these games, like people think nostalgically for, which I think is, I mean, it's nice in a lot of ways, but it's kind of a strange thing. But and I was thinking about, oh, in a Nintendo Power, there was like a article section in some of the issues with this guy and this girl who kind of are, it's supposed to be like kind of like, hey, we're like, you know, connecting with the fans and stuff like that. There was one we were reading for Star Fox 64 where it was like, we'll tell you how to get online on Nintendo.com and check out stuff. And it was like, it's meant to be like personable and relatable. And I was like, that's like such a career that now seems like, I guess it is, has transitioned into like people doing that on YouTube, but it's crazy to think about doing that, you know, for a magazine. Like just in my lifetime, that's barely been a thing, you know, or like it's been slowly dying too dead in my lifetime, you know.
It was kind of wild, speaking of like the website, it's kind of wild to me seeing like them advertise a website on these VHS videos from like the mid-90s. I'm like, the internet would have been so, you know, so quite young then. Like, crazy that they even had them, like, you know, I think they advertised on the Star Fox one, like, go to, you know, www.starfox.com or starfox64.com, and I'm like, I've got to try this, and it doesn't go anywhere. And I was like, oh, that's sad. But like, imagine, I don't know, just, yeah, I kind of don't think of the era of VHS and the era of the internet overlapping very much, but obviously there was, you know, a small amount there, at the end.
That's one thing we've picked up on doing the show is, you know, when we're looking at, like, everything from that time period, like, everyone in 1996 and 1997 is talking about having a website and going on the internet. We didn't watch it. Back months ago, I listened to the State of the Union address, and Bill Clinton was like, we got websites. And I was like, okay, cool. Like, everyone's, I mean, I guess we're going into the new era, you know, the internet age. So everyone's stoked about that, which is good and bad in a lot of ways.
It was a different time back then when like everyone, you know, sort of, yeah, had a website. Now it's like, you know, everyone's just on like Reddit or YouTube or whatever, but back in the day, everyone just had their own website. It was, yeah, different time. The Wild West.
I do kind of miss just going to a website. I don't really do that anymore.
Oh, yeah.
I go to Google Docs all the time. That's about it.
Yeah. Yeah.
How would you, the first tape we watched, The Invasion of Nintendo, there is, we mentioned a little bit the storyline. Why don't you tell people what's the storyline for the SNES Invasion of Nintendo?
Now, your next assignment won't be so easy. It's information no one, absolutely no one has. It's a smuggled video from the Shoshenkai show in Japan. Get it, and don't let it out of your sight. Get it?
The big reason we're talking about this was, Ryan, you said this is the first footage that Nintendo ever sent out that contained footage of like N64. It's mostly like there's some shots too, but yeah,
still mostly, yeah, I think it's like all still images.
Yeah. So yeah, there is that part too where they literally send the guys, well, supposedly mm-hmm. someone just took footage of the event.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and he's like adding interesting commentary to it. they like walk in, they're like, "Oh, did you bring the tickets? No, you were supposed to bring the tickets."
Yeah, it's very like juvenile, like, you know, like as mm-hmm. a kid, I probably would have thought like it's the funniest thing ever.
Mm-hmm. mm-hmm.
And then Howard Lincoln's there and he's just telling them like, go away, yeah. basically.
Yeah, they go in, they're like, hey, you, where's the tapes?
They clearly just got like random other, I don't know if the other people they talked to were anybody, but it was just like, let's get some, like, they're probably like, hey, you want to be in our little video thing? This event,
Shoshinkai.
Shoshinkai, yeah.
Which would become Space World later.
Oh, okay. Well, cool. Then mm-hmm. there's a lot of history there for sure.
Mm-hmm.
This was, I mean, not only was this like the first, I think this was the first place anyone saw like N64 stuff, right? Outside of Nintendo. I remember reading the article from Nintendo Power after it, and it was all about, like, yeah, everyone's, like, hyped about the N64 now, like, it's finally been revealed type thing. I think this was, like, the video they had, like, really felt like they were revealing it. It was kind of awesome with the music and everything.
Yeah, I think this most likely would have been filmed. I don't actually know when that event took place, but probably like either before or like, yeah, it would. No, it was in 95. So it would have been before the Japanese launch because it launched in Japan in June 96. Mm. So yeah, that would have probably been the first public showing, I'm guessing, but not totally sure.
It also had that iconic footage. It was like the very first footage of Ocarina of Time. Back when it was just called Zelda 64, and yes. like I think they had a few stills of that in the video, and seeing those brought me right back. I was like, oh, yeah, oh, that video was very hype. Yeah,
I don't. I think I don't like remember the hype for Ocarina of Time as much because I was kind of like that's really I was already like had played and beaten at least one Zelda game I had beaten at least at the time, but it was like before I was like a big Zelda fan, you know, like that era was mm-hmm. really what solidified it. So like, but I've become like retroactively nostalgic of that footage. Cause you know, now it's been 20 years of being a diehard Zelda fan. And I just, mm-hmm. you know, have seen that so much and it's so weird. Cause it looks like Ocarina of Time, but it like does not look like Ocarina of Time at all in a lot of ways too.
Yeah, it was like so early in development. Yeah, it really changed a lot by the time they got to the end game.
Yeah, it wouldn't come out for like 2.5 more years, I think. So
yeah, they keep teasing it in Nintendo Power. It's in like almost every issue. It feels like they'll just post a little screenshot.
Did it get delayed or anything? It feels like it's such a long time for it did.
I think I remember reading in the Nintendo Power, like, they'd have the list of upcoming, and at one point it had, like, I think the year before, it listed the year before, like, 97.
What was the delayed game discourse like about Ocarina of Time? Because every Zelda game has it.
it was brutal. Like being an N64 owner. Like obviously, like the internet and social media didn't exist. So and like forums, I certainly wasn't on forums. But like, I mean, I had conversations with friends and everything, and you know, it was always like, okay, there's a dry spell for N64. We just gotta hold out a little bit longer. Like Zelda's coming, 1997. Zelda's coming.
Yeah.
And eventually, like my friends and I were just like, "Fuck it, I'm getting a PlayStation." I'm sorry, I can't. Like, there's Final Fantasy VII, there's Castlevania Symphony of the Night, Resident Evil. I can't be this one N64 guy. War Gods isn't gonna do it.
No,
it's not gonna tide me over. Sorry, Gronks.
Hey, be careful. He'll come for you. He's hard to beat.
It kind of reminds me of the Wii U era again, like where it was like, yeah, Zelda for Wii U, it's coming, guys. Like, here's this tech demo. Like, get ready for Zelda Wii U. And yeah.
Yeah, that's
we
like.
We all know how that ended up.
I mean, we're a Nintendo-based podcast, but it's like, yeah, they really can be like, we've got you. Like, you're going to buy this Zelda. Like, that's like, I don't even play a lot of, like, I play, like, occasionally a new game, but not as much as a lot of people we know. And, you know, I spend a lot of time playing old games, obviously, but it's like, if a new Zelda game comes out, it's like, I have to drop, you know, whatever I'm doing to play it. I don't have to, like, I'm compelled to, I cannot not play it. So it's like, I remember that feeling in the Wii U era of being like, well, I mean, I guess I mean, it's cool. I can play Twilight Princess. That's fine.
Yeah, I bought my Wii U just to play Wind Waker HD. And I was so hyped for that. And I got the one with the, you know, the gamepad with the...
Oh, yeah.
I must be one of only like six people that has one over here. But yeah.
Ooh, that's a rare item.
It was great. And then Smash came out. You know, I don't know. I think the Wii U was great, but obviously I'm...
Well, we'll save it for the Wii U. The Wii U flashback. Wii U.
I
2035.
I was on a Nintendo podcast through the entirety of the Wii U era, and like we tried to keep things positive, and we're a weekly show about Nintendo, and it definitely got to the point where we were like doing like full episodes just talking about like Game Boy Advance games that were on the Virtual Console, and we're like, there's this.
That reminds me, this is a way off a tangent, but it reminds me of our friends over on the Zelda cast who do a weekly Zelda show, and in the lead up to Tears of the Kingdom, like until like, you know, whatever, not even a year before, it was like, okay, so I guess this week we can do a retrospective on the items in the Minish Cap or, you know, something. Or it's like, what do we talk about? There's no news.
So there's this hat.
Yeah. Let's really get into the hat theory.
Deep dive.
So for the invasion of Nintendo, the N64 package at the end, McKenna, how hyped do you think that would have gotten you for the N64? Based off the game shown. And honestly, a lot of the game, not a lot, a majority of them are ones we've now played. But there are a couple that have yet to come.
It's like the real.
It's sort of, yeah, they both, actually meant all of them, I think, pretty much had like a, here's the games we have coming. But so it might be hard to remember all of them. But I guess there was a lot of crossover.
Like all right in a row.
we did watch them back to back to back. And then again today, we did. But I mean, they're all kind of from a similar-ish era.
This is like a lot of the ones we've played already. Plus, I feel like some ones that are still in the maybe a year away.
Yeah, well, there's some that don't even come out, which is kind of interesting to see. Kirby Air Ride. Yeah, I was like unsure if that was a real game or not. I had to like look it up. There was also
it's real.
I think some of the
it eventually happened. Wow. That's a GameCube case, though. what else? There was in one of them they had Earthbound, didn't they? Or is that I'm maybe thinking of the Nintendo?
That's in Nintendo Power.
They're hyping that
lot.
In Nintendo Power. So there's some like
Mother 64.
I mean, I guess that happens all the time with game, like that's like Metroid Prime 4. We're seeing that kind of now, like. What's up with that? But it does seem like a weird thing. Like they're showing footage and like screenshots of these games that just never come out. And it's like,
is this the one where that has Shadows and Star Fox?
I think
there's
Shadows...
one where they're, I feel like they're like going back and forth between those. So it like almost looks like they're sharing gameplay.
Oh, yeah.
It feels like, interesting editing choice.
Which one is giving the other the rub, do you think? They're both pretty good in the space combat.
Yeah, aspect, I think Star Fox 64 definitely has some flashier looking stuff.
Yeah. So, like, yeah, in terms of that, like, video package, like, yeah, what was, I guess, did that hype you up, Ryan, at the time, like, when you saw this? Did you see this one at the time?
I did not see this actual video. I never got this one. It literally must have been lost in the mail, but, I do remember, like, these games. Like, I had a Nintendo Power subscription, mm-hmm. and what I can tell you from this era is I was hyped AF for Body Harvest.
Body Harvest, yeah. That's...
because that was one that they were like, this is the game. Body Harvest and Mission Impossible.
Both of those seem like very, like, much, like, not Nintendo 64, like, what you think of at all. Or, like, really even Nintendo, so... it is interesting. Yeah. I feel like there is some of that with, like... it almost feels strange. Like, some of the games we've played that remind me of that, where I'm like, it's weird this is even on the console. But I guess they had to have games that weren't just, you know... They wanted to kind of appeal to everyone, I guess, it seems. So, mm-hmm. even Super Nintendo had that a little bit, you know, where they kind of... they had some stuff that was more... not their style. They're kind of like hedging a little bit, you know. The one other thing that stood out to me in that was there was some footage. There was a screenshot of Wave Race when they were still like trying to make it like F-Zero.
Hydro Thunder. Yeah.
They've got like a big vehicle type thing, like a sci-fi vehicle on the water, which is kind of a game. I think they should still make that. I think that's a good idea.
They should.
Or like they should make another F-Zero game where it's like. They could be like Diddy Kong Racing. Go on the water, go in the sky, you know, why not?
On September 29th, N64 is scheduled for release in North America. The system is about to change. But before it does, we decided to invite three of the best gamers in the country to put it to the test. This is N64.
Let's talk about the other videos. Change the System. Mm-hmm. There's some interesting stuff that I wanted to mention in here.
Oh, yeah.
This one did not have, you know, people weren't infiltrating. This was, we're inviting the top gamers in the world to come and experience the N64. And I honestly love, like, when these type of things, advertisement or even, like, popular media, like, news stories and whatever at the time have to, like, communicate the gaming world to people. Like, mm-hmm. that maybe don't know the gaming world, because when they're introducing these guys, like, the way they, like, are trying to present their, like, bona fides or whatever are very funny.
You've got David Chessel, a.k.a. Quickfinger. Martial arts and sportscaster. You have Brian O'Rourke, a.k.a. Extended Play, action and adventure expert. And Steve Greaves, a.k.a. Game Face. Unbeatable.
It's like no one can check. No one can check that.
I actually looked him up because I was like, I wonder what happened to those guys. And
you did.
What happened to so they have, two of them have IMDb pages, the first two. So
are they credited David for being Chessel? In this?
David Chessel, yeah, they are. It's credited. It's got a page on IMDb. Oh. But apparently David Chessel went on to work as a film editor and worked on the Tekken 2010 movie. And
I've not seen
even more recently, won Best Editor at the MTV Music Video Awards for his work on Olivia Rodrigo's music video for Vampire.
Whoa. So,
wow.
There's your fun fact. And then you've got Brian O'Rourke, who didn't do much, and then Steve Greaves, a.k.a. Game Face, was never seen again.
No one could beat him.
He couldn't be beaten. His work here was done.
I love that. It actually reminded me of, again, slightly off topic, but there's this guy from a different, who used to be, I don't know if he still is. I don't follow who is at what Zelda fan sites anymore, but there's this guy who is one of the people at Zelda Universe and we kind of interact with some of them. I don't know him as well, but he's this fella. Well, you know, I won't put him on blast, but he was on the back in the day, he was on the Australian edition of Beauty and the Geek. I don't know if you remember that show. So they're trying to, you know, they're trying to give this guy credits, you know, like what's his sort of like claim to geekdom, you know, his claim to fame. And the stat comes on the screen and it says, one of the top five Legend of Zelda players in the world. It's like, what does it mean
to be... How are you ranking this?
How do I get on that list of, like, the best Zelda players in the world? Is it, like, speed? I don't know. Anyway, yeah, I loved, like, you know, it's cool, like, it's cool to know, like, oh, this guy's a martial arts expert. Like, as a kid, I would have seen that, and I would have been like, this is who I, this is what I want to be when I grow up. Is a expert quick finger. I want to be quick finger.
Yeah.
When they're going around, they totally have that sort of vibe. You're talking maybe not full Spicoli, but you know what I mean? Everyone is like, everyone's got a tude for sure. And then even, we mentioned, I really was cracking up when they go talk to, Henry again, when Henry, he's showing them Mario, right? He's showing them Mario 64.
He's showing them Shadows.
Okay.
I think Ken Lobb shows them Mario.
Yes. Yeah. And he does Ken Lobb does a great job of showing off them how all the little intricacies, like, it is like all these things have the sort of little like marketing buzzwords about all the games that they're trying to communicate. But I'm like, when Ken Lobb is showing all the stuff about Mario, I'm like, true. Yeah. Oh, hell yeah. You're right, man. That is cool.
It's just stuff that we take for granted now. But when he's like, oh, you know, you move the analog stick a little bit and Mario will tiptoe, like, that was mind-blowing back then. You know, now it's like, yes, I know how an analog stick works, Ken. Like, come on, mate. But
there's something about it. The way they describe it, I'm like, yeah, that's crazy. I don't know. Still blows my mind.
Yeah.
I love when they, like, go in there and they first, like, meet Ken Lobb and he, like, runs his hands through his hair and where he says, like, so, I understand you're here to learn about the Nintendo 64.
we were just watching that and our buddy Nico, our roommate, caught it and was like, he's so, this is really creepy right now. So I feel bad. I don't think she should be portrayed in such a light.
And it's got that little mustache happening there, and I know I can't talk, but, like, you know, that also, I think, adds to it.
I thought he looked, you know, the stash looked good on him. It's just, you know, it was just, like, not a flattering lighting, you know, close-up on his face, you know, it's all the... It was definitely better. I actually liked it in the previous video where they had a part where his mother was, like, berating him. Yes, I was like, okay,
so good.
I like this. It's, like, it's a little bit more humble, you know, a little bit...
That was his torture. The other ones, it was like, we're going to break your thumbs. And for him, it's like, here's your mum.
Yeah. There he is, Mr. Game Player. We didn't bring you up to play games all day. We had big plans for you. You were going to go to Harvard. Now you're in Redmond. Your sister's a doctor. Your brother's a banker. And what are you? A gamer. You weren't always like this. But now look at you. Cumbles, slappies. Where did we go wrong?
Okay, I'll talk.
But when I do want to talk about when they're showing them Shadows of the Empire, because, like, he's describing all these different features, but he's like, he's also like kind of like whatever about it, you know. He's like, yeah, you know, and you're like, and some of the terms are really funny. He's like, you're in like a maze style level, like Pac-Man, like what. Such a weird term to describe some of the gameplay. He seemed kind of blasé about some of the things. Oh, this is my favorite part.
Yeah. Well, he does, like, as soon as they're in there, he's like, I guess I'll cut to the chase and get to my favorite part, the game.
Yes.
Like, what? I don't understand.
I don't know. You expect that kind of, like, sort of stuff from, like, a direct would almost add, like, kind of, like, cheesy lines like that. But it's so funny here where they're, like, you can tell he's, like, he's trying to come off cool for sure. Yeah. Like, whether or not he knows how, like, goofy the video is, I think he's, like, this is, like, cool. I'm, like, almost too cool for this video.
Yeah. I play video games for a living. Cool.
Which of the three guys was your favorite, McKenna? Who would you want to like learn about a game from?
Let's see. There it was.
We had Henry, who told us about Shadows. Ken for Mario, and then Armin for Pilot Wings in this one.
Oh, definitely the Pilot Wing.
He was very
That seemed I don't know. He seemed like really chill about it. I remember him talking about that one, like Pilot Wings dive where you go through like all the rings.
That level they show off. I don't know if you've done that. That's like, I feel like that's a hard challenge.
And then he's just like, oh, don't forget to, you know, pull up at the end.
He made it look easy.
He's like, oh my god, that mm-hmm. was so hard when we were doing it.
It took us like 20 tries to do that.
Yeah.
I mean, he's a professional, you know. He should be good.
Plays video games for a living.
Yeah. Armand, Armand was also my favorite in the Invasion video where they turn up and they're like, you know, tell us about, you know, I can't remember what it was, Donkey Kong. And he's like, nah, you can kill me and I still wouldn't talk. And then they open up the suitcases of money and he's like, nah, have a seat, gentlemen. Like,
he's easily bought.
So well.
Yeah. He's so corrupt.
Yeah. And then like, there's a later shot where they're like, tell us more. And he's like counting his money. He's like, yeah, I'll tell you everything.
yeah,
no, he was great.
No torture, Mario torture required, I guess.
Well, we'll get to that.
I feel like he was also the most humanized in this video as well, because they have that like clip of him like getting like frustrated but like laughing, and he's like pretending to throw the controller. And I was like, that seems legit. Like he seems real.
That was something that we talked about it a little bit, sort of jumping ahead, but like with the Rumble Pack. We talked about it in our Star Fox episode about how, like, one of the big things you notice about the Rumble Pack is there's a lot of rumbles for when you get hit and when you die. And it seems like there was actually, like, almost sort of like an encouraged fun factor to, like, you dying or failing in a video game and other people, like, watching and laughing and stuff. And it was like, you know, I sort of liked that. That was, like, it encouraged, like, hey, it's kind of fun when you're playing Pilot Wings and you smash your hang glider into the side of a cliff. It's like actually hilarious, you know, like the way they present it where they're all like losing their shit is like maybe a little too much. But it is like we had a lot of great times in Pilot Wings, like losing
all the like goofy screams. The...
It is also like it was that era where, you know, a lot of households only had one or two TVs. So if someone was going to be playing a ostensibly single player game, you wanted it to be entertaining for everyone that was sitting around forced to watch. Like,
yeah.
You know, so...
Armin, I think, actually had kind of the energy of like he's like the type of guy I would want to learn like how to actually like skydive from, or like like teach me how to fly a plane. There's just something like very positive, and like you said, like he's laughing and self-deprecating, like he had the most Nintendo vibe of all of them, you know.
Yeah, totally.
One last thing that I could think of from this video that really stuck out was in the video where they're like, you know, showing all the crazy features and stuff like that. One that they really hammer home is they're like, it has a Z button. Which is pretty crazy. I don't think anybody had a Z button before this.
I thought buttons only went up to Y.
X, Y. What'll they do now? Which is really, it's just like, there's nothing really that special about the Z button, I don't think.
I mean, it's on the back of the controller.
There's something special about the Z button.
Okay.
I can't put it into words, but it's special.
What do you think about the Z button as like, because you haven't really like played a lot on N64, but how are you like acclimating to the Z button?
I mean, it's like the back buttons you have. Now you have two of them.
Don't say that.
Now I'm just used to having two Z buttons in there, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Behind
it's making certain NSO games kind of annoying, because
we talked about
that in Star Fox, but L and R are like the matching ones, but you actually want R and Z to be the matching ones, and so you're playing, you know. Yeah, anyway,
I just I associate it with Z targeting.
Z targeting.
Totally.
There, I mean, there's, yeah, like, a lot of features, mm-hmm. actually, that, it, like, the Z button kind of gets lumped in with, and I think, I mean, in Mario, it's actually kind of adds a lot to the game, so, yeah, it's easy to make fun of, but I don't know.
It's speaking cool. of what I would call the Z button, there's definitely a few shots there where they're playing a game that definitely requires you to hold the middle grip, and they're holding the controller via the outside grips. And I'm like, oh, that's a sure hope someone got fired for that blunder.
Wait, you know? Who's doing that? Are you saying like Game Face?
I think it might have been one of the kids. No, it might have been Game Face, actually. Yeah, we'd have to go back and review the footage.
Well, maybe he knows something we don't. That's why he's unbeatable.
Oh, yeah. He's playing a different alternate control scheme where you use the D-pad or something. Yeah.
Yeah, overall, I thought this was, like, a fun tape. I like mm-hmm. they, you know, they just threw in so many random little, like, non-sequitur. Mm-hmm. You know, you talked about the shaky cam and stuff, but they'd randomly be, like, you know, they're walking down the hall, and they're like, oh, let's goof around with this object. It's almost like they're doing, like, improv with like, random objects in the room. I don't
yeah,
know.
Yeah, they're, like... They are full teens in this video yeah. because they are also commenting on everything. Like, the kids are just constantly commenting, which is very teen. Because there's, like, the part where they all, like, harmonize and say 360.
Oh, yeah. And they're like, yeah, 360.
360.
And, like, I just picture them, like, high-fiving and stuff. Like, so sick. But, like, give him a toss, man. He ain't nothing.
He ain't nothing. That's what I was talking about. They're, like, so getting yeah. so, like, hyped on, like a Bowser boss fight, which is, I mean, it's yeah. cool, but it's
just, pretty hype.
It's like, not, like, the way they present it is, like, they're radical, you know. Well, I don't know. Maybe Mario's pretty radical. I don't want to say he's not, but yeah, I don't know. The hype they have for it is it's kind of infectious, honestly. Yeah. We watched this before, like I had it on like way back when we first started, because I was just like playing random old media I could find, and it definitely helped me get into the mindset of that early N64 era and like what is what's on the horizon, I guess. So
one thing that also stood out to me, and it was interesting that we were saying before about how these were sort of the precursor to modern Nintendo Directs, was, you know, at the end they show the Killer Instinct trailer, and that had a real, like, one more thing vibe, you know, which
it
kind
totally
of, yeah,
was
very much, yeah, it was like, oh, this is, you know, exactly like a modern Direct where they, you know, reveal a Smash character or whatever. I was like, oh, that's, yeah, that's awesome.
Is Killer Instinct Gold, do you think, like, a good game for that? Like, I have a hard time judging.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Because I personally do love that game now, but you know what I mean? It wasn't one that, at the time, I don't know if people would have been like, oh, shit, you know?
And what's great about that is, like, it works on so many levels, and because... In the first video, the first VHS, the Donkey Kong Country Exposed, they play through the video credits, and it's like brought to you by Nintendo Power, and then it cuts back to the guy who's like filming it, and he's got like his shaky cam and stuff, and he's like, whoa, what's in this room? And he like opens up the door, and it's a bunch of like Nintendo employees playing Killer Instinct on the SNES.
Oh.
And they're like, get out of here, you can't see this. And then it like drops the camera. So then like, yeah, having this as like another, you know, one more thing was huge. And I was super hyped for Killer Instinct Gold back in the day.
So it's like one of those things where it's like, this feels like, you know, so much of the tone we talked about and stuff, it feels like it's like a whole different era. But then this is true about like a lot of aspects about Nintendo, where it's like there's some things like they've actually have just been doing for a long time. And they, you know, they're not ones to not like, they'll reuse old ideas in new games that you're like, oh, wow, I can't believe they made that work. So like, I don't know, I guess the Nintendo Directs They've got a longer lineage than people even associate them with now.
Word on the street is you got a new Nintendo 64 game coming out.
Could you be a little more specific? We got a lot of new games coming out.
Star Fox 64. Test pilot boy.
You want to know about Star Fox 64, eh?
Yeah, and you'd better tell us all you know. Or else!
How about the Star Fox video? And this is the one that I think has the most... This one has the most overt plot, I think, really. It really feels like... Well, maybe because it's about one game, but... What happens in this one?
Man. Lands. He's parachuting into his office.
Oh, I forgot about the parachuting.
Which is wild. And then you got these two guys with walkie-talkies, and one goes... The eagle has landed.
they just start. They're walking around with Sega and Sony sweaters on. They're flaunting it. And what's their plan here? I was very confused by like what their actual plan was.
Well, so the parachute guy, I think his name's Peter. They they want to kidnap Peter and find out. Star Fox 64. I think that's the goal.
The thing is,
but we'll get to the plot holes in a minute.
Okay, I was gonna say they find out about it, and it's like the worst thing ever. And I'm like, but you got what you wanted, guys. Like, I guess it's like it's too good. They can't even believe it.
But firstly, I think I would recommend everyone listening to the podcast pause and go and watch this video because
it's really
absolutely
good.
Amazing. Yeah. I've got the actual, so I was saying how it's got an IMDb page. I've got the excerpt from the page. This is great. If this doesn't convince you to go and watch it, I don't know what will, but this is what the description is. A promotional VHS tape where two employees from Sega and Sony torture a Nintendo employee to get info out of him about the new Star Fox 64 game and Rumble Pack. Like, go watch it.
Yeah.
The fact, like, this is one where it's like, This is all actors, I think. Like, it's like they hired actors to come in and do these. So compared to the other ones where it's like they had like people who work for Nintendo and real gamers apparently come in. I don't know. The kids were probably actors.
I think they were, yeah.
But like, you know, that one had like sort of those other ones had sort of like that, like the like goofball, like a different sort of corny Nintendo charm where it's like you're watching people whose job it is, who are like nerds essentially, like have to kind of like be cool and sell you a game, where this was like we hired actors off the street to, you know, kind of act. I don't know, they all brought a very like, it reminded me of watching Power Rangers, like the two guys were like very like bulk and skull, like is very like ham-fisted acting and corny in a certain
so
way.
So over the top. It's an actual crime that the actors are uncredited, because I feel like there's some Oscar-worthy performances here that have clearly gone unrecognized.
Even the people you didn't expect, like the freaking scientist guy.
Bob. Got a pizza for Bob.
So they kidnap a guy who is skydiving, as you mentioned, and they He's supposed to be, he's a test pilot for Star Fox, right? I guess.
I describe him as wish.com Nathan Fillion, I think.
Yeah. They get him to speak to reveal the information about Star Fox by, they're going to torture Mario, which is like, this is like torturing like a religious figure to him almost, you know, he could not take this. So he spills the beans on it, on the game to them, in a very, you know, sales pitch kind of way, very radical sales pitch. The game, it sounds so good to them that they're actually like, they're so upset. But then it's like, but there's more, you know. I love the tease of that. Of like already what he's revealed is like so mind blowing, but it doesn't not stop there. They got to get Bob involved. So what's Bob do again? He's just like a game designer, but he's wearing like a lab coat, isn't he?
games are a science. I don't know. There's a connection.
Yeah.
It reminds me
they
like,
had to distinguish him. They had to distinguish him from Peter. So they, mm-hmm. I don't know.
Pilot. They take like the, I guess the, it's like very literal. You know, this guy plays, he plays the Star Fox game. So he's like a pilot. This guy, he's mm-hmm. in the lab cooking up games, you mm-hmm. know?
Yeah. Yeah.
And I think, you know, I guess there's plot holes, but I guess it kind of makes sense because they actually get them playing the game and they play them in some multiplayer, and it just mm-hmm. It's almost like they win them over, but then at the end they dunk on the Sega guys and leave them to be sad. So I was sort of like, hey, if this happened now, if they made this now, they would have befriended them, you know, and been like,
yeah.
Now announcing cross-platform play or something, you know.
They would have all been playing Switch at a rooftop party somewhere. Yeah.
With Karen.
Yeah.
Yeah. Karen,
I feel like the zinger, the like most, okay, there's two like ultra quotable lines, I think, in this. And these are like, this is as cool as like my friends and I were in this era, like we would like watch this and like quote it, and like it's like one of those things where you're like, I think this, I like this thing, it's like kind of bad, but I don't really know how to like articulate it because I don't really understand media, but like we're just gonna like watch it a lot, and we're gonna talk about it and quote it a lot, and you know, it's just what you do. And there's the part where they're like, we heard you got a new game coming out, and Peter's like, which one? We've got plenty of them.
Oh.
Something along those lines. And he's like so rude about it.
It also feels like they're like, no, seriously, like the N64 has all kinds of games, okay?
Yeah. Like there's so many. We just haven't announced any, and they haven't
trust
come
us,
out
guys,
yet.
Trust us.
Yeah. Which was kind of the vibe of Nintendo 64 in a lot of ways. Then there's then you kind of alluded to this earlier, like the second big reveal before, like the first big reveal is like Star Fox 64 kicks ass.
Yeah.
And then like the second big reveal is when like Bob comes to after being like gassed with the pizza, and
nice effects too. I like the smoke effect or whatever.
Oh, have. it looks awesome. And then, but he's just like, you, Peter, you didn't tell him about the Rumble Pack, and then the henchmen are like, no, but you just did. So yeah, my friends and I would constantly be like, you didn't tell them about the Rumble Pack.
<That's>, that probably was the first time as a kid, like I would imagine that you probably ever saw someone do that. Like, no, but you just did. I think for me that happens in Austin Powers, which also is from the same time. And as a kid, I was like, I didn't fully get that it was like a comedy. Full, I knew it was funny, but I was like, I was like, wow, like he is like a really good spy.
You guys, you don't know the half of it.
What? There's more?
Well, yeah. But Bob would kill me if I told you.
Well, we'll just have to get this Bob guy to tell us himself.
With the Rumble Pack, there's a quotable line there too, where they're like, they do the thing where they're like, you can feel the game. And then the other guy goes, he just repeats the exact same thing back to him. He says something like, wait a minute, are you telling me you can feel the game? It's like, yeah.
Really makes you feel like you're playing Star Fox.
They're like, when you get blown up, you feel it, which is again something that I think is such a strange like way to like advertise it, that like it's really gonna, it's, and that's when it goes off the hardest in the game, is when it is rumbling. when you're dying.
There was another amazing quote in that video. It's like at the end where they're like, oh, here's the official game guide for Star Fox 64. And he's like, oh, yeah, give it to, I think it's Sega, or sorry, I think it's Sony. Sony's like, oh, give it here. And he's like, you can buy it at the store.
The delivery
on that line is great. Excuse my terrible imitation accent, but yeah.
No,
that was Oscar-worthy again.
That was like a legitimately, that was like a funny line. I don't know if they really knew how funny it was, but.
Yeah, amazing. So,
I have the video right here. I just grabbed it off my shelf.
Look at that.
And so on the video, this is great. It says, see how it feels to feel what you see.
Oh, wordplay. Chills. 9,000.
Amazing.
Wow. Yeah.
You know, ChatGPT didn't write that.
No.
So we talked about this in our Star Fox episode, but I guess, I don't know, Matt. Because you played a lot of these on like an emulator like later on, so like was the Rumble Pack, was that like a hype thing at the time for you at all?
Yeah. So I never played any of these games with Rumble. I should probably mention, actually, speaking of localization, that Star Fox 64, most people know this, it was not called that in Power Regions. It was called Lilat Wars.
Yeah.
With the Super Nintendo one being called Star Wing, rather than Star Fox. No idea why.
I think there's another media property or something called Star Fox or something. I can't remember. I feel like I should have remembered this, but
I probably should have looked it up too. But we always had Lilat Wars. I never knew, like, because I had friends with N64s growing up, and even when we played there, I don't know anyone that had the Rumble Pack. I don't think it was I don't know if it wasn't pack-in here, or just people lost them or broke them. I don't know. I just don't remember ever using them. Yeah.
Yeah. So like Rumble and controllers is just something that it just
came in with the Xbox
happened.
For me. Yeah,
for sure.
Yeah.
What about Ryan? Were you like in the Rumble hype?
Oh yeah. So I have my copy of Star Fox 64 here. Ginormous box. It's a real big boy. Love this thing. I don't know. Like, I'm kind of just like at that like boomer point in my life where just like I'm just nostalgic for everything.
Yep.
And I just like love old stuff like so much. And I don't even know if I'm like manufacturing these feelings or because I'm just like not into what's happening elsewhere in the world now or just like the natural part of getting old. But I've been replaying Ocarina of Time on an N64 for the first time.
It's been amazing
so
to
long,
see.
So long. And I got like the Stone of Agony, which is the Rumble Pack feature. And, you know, like I went, grabbed my Rumble Pack, found some AAA batteries and like plugged it in. And like, it makes the controller all like weird and like kind of like top heavy. But like, I don't know, there's just something really special and unique about the Rumble Pack. And I think like, part of it is like it's just weird, like it makes no sense to like stick this in like the back of a controller and make this like bizarre shape to an already bizarrely shapen controller, and it like feels super weird and like
it doesn't rumble like the way you think of rumble now.
Yeah,
it's like kind of all over. Like, it is feel like it's like at the end of your controller, like, and you're trying to like
it's hold so, on to it. Like bizarre, but there's just like something like really cool and unique about it. So basically what I'm saying is like I still feel today what Sega and Sony felt in that scene where they're like I can't believe this shit. That's how I still feel today about the Rumble Pack.
So speaking of, like, obviously we don't have like a full podcast worth of time to talk about this, but you got it then packed in with Star Fox. So what, like, what was it like, you know, when you first played Star Fox, like back when it came out?
It was amazing. Like yeah. it was literally like unprecedented. And I think there had been like force feedback, like accessories, and there had been like weird like vests that you put on to like play Sega Genesis games and they like shock you or something. I have no idea. Like I never really had any of those like yeah. kind of accessories. But like Star Fox was like a regular like retail price, like first party Nintendo game that just like came with this thing. Mm-hmm. And like so it made the technology like super accessible for people, because like you could just go into like any store and like I was like a huge fan of the Super Nintendo Star Fox, so it was like
yeah.
you know, this game's gonna be sick, like this is gonna be worth the, you know, ridiculous N64 price for this, but like you're also getting the Rumble Pack, so it's like basically free, like and I had never like experienced anything like that before, and it was so cool at the time.
So you were also into the SNES game. So like, did you have feelings like when they sort of like canceled Star Fox 2 and then announced Star Fox 64? Like, was that sort of one of those times where, similar to Zelda, where it's like, when is this going to come out? Or did you have that sort of journey with that?
Yeah, I mean, I was like pretty okay with, by the time Star Fox 2 got like canceled, I was like full on board for the N64, and like, and this, it's actually like a huge regret, like, because I traded in like my, you know, Super Nintendo and Genesis to get like a Nintendo 64, and
every episode someone has a similar story, and it's like
I like box copies of like Earthbound and Chrono Trigger and all that was all traded in, but you know, hindsight is 2020. Yeah,
you can't blame yourself. You're a kid.
Yeah, and yeah, I was a kid, and like I had no job. It was literally illegal for me to have a job at that age.
Fair.
But I feel like I also like missed out on all those like sick like late Super Nintendo games, because I like had just gotten rid of my system to put my Toys R Us pre-order for Nintendo 64. So even like watching that Invasion of Nintendo video, it's like, oh, man, I really did miss out on Mario RPG at that time.
Yeah.
Like in like late 95 and, you know, early 96, whatever. But
yeah,
I was like, I was like, don't even make Super Nintendo games anymore. I just want Nintendo 64.
So okay, that
cancel them all.
Wow.
Yeah, no, I could totally get that. At the time, there was like a lot of, like, you know, we want the new, we don't care about the old. Mm-hmm. And then now you're like, oh, like these were both like awesome consistently, yeah, pretty much at
yeah.
the time.
Actually, yeah. It's like, oh, actually, Donkey Kong Country 2 was better than, like, half of the N64 library.
Yeah. Donkey Kong Country 3 also.
That was out when the N64 was out, yeah.
Literally just played it for, like, the first time this year. And I was whoa, this game is amazing. And I, like, completely slept on it for so long.
That's really, like, kind of that stuff sort of, I guess, because, you know, you're thinking, at the time, you're thinking of, like, as someone who is owning this expensive console that I paid for and I want things to play on it. But like now looking back, like it's like when you look at Nintendo's output in 1996, it's like there's Donkey Kong Country 3 and Mario RPG. Like there's a lot of games across the Game Boy, Super Nintendo and N64 that are all awesome. But yeah, maybe if you only have one, it's like you're a little bit starved for content at the time. Matt, I think you had written down like Star Fox as like a game you were also down to talk about. So like, what was, I assume that means you played it back in the day. Is that a game you've always been a fan
of? Yeah. I wouldn't say I've played it like a whole lot. But on the emulator, I definitely remember having a go at it. It might've been a bit later, and then definitely at like mates' places, that was one that you'd bust out the multiplayer and crowd around the 15-inch CRT, and like, you know, it was, yeah, I vague but fond memories of that. Yeah. I was never very good at it. I think still not very good at it.
It's pretty tough, honestly. But it's not as tough as the SNES ones, but you know.
Oh yeah, that's on another level, yeah.
For sure.
Peter, you didn't tell him about the Rumble Pack, did you?
No. Bob, you just did.
You know, we don't normally do this on like shows with guests, but it was great you suggested like this episode, but I thought it was also just another excuse to get more people on to talk about Star Fox. And I thought it'd be fun, actually, since we, Ryan, we use your ranking system to rank these games. It's I forgot the name for it, but it's your patented ranking system where we score the game based on vibes and fun factor out of 5.
All that matters.
And I thought it might be fun. We've already, like, our at this point, you haven't heard it, but our episode on Star Fox 64 has come out. So I thought maybe we could give it our scores, but also we would allow you guys to maybe score. You haven't maybe given a replayer much thought, but just based on your memories of the game, how would you guys rank Star Fox 64 out of 5 based on vibes and fun factor?
I'm such an unreliable narrator when it comes to these sort of things.
You're like, 5, 5, 5. Every
how can I not? you mentioned like maybe you haven't been like thinking about Star Fox 64. There is not a day that goes by that I don't think about Star Fox 64.
For sure.
Like, I think what, you know, I really enjoyed the game. I got it, you know, when I was younger, had tons of fun with it. And then I think like what really solidified it as an all-timer was the 3DS version when that came out.
Yeah.
And then I played through it. You know, I bought it, and then I played through it again there, and I was like, this is like an almost perfect video game. Like, it's just it's just such good video game right here. And, you know, the music's awesome, like it looks awesome. The talking specifically about the N64 version, there's like the branching paths, there's like so many secrets. It's also just like it's a perfect length. You can just like play through it in like, you know, like a couple of hours or less, and then but you can like keep going back to it because there's so many secrets, and like you're saving your scores to the cartridge and, you know, trying to beat your scores. Yeah. So it's like super replayable. It's like hilariously quotable. There's so much personality, like, and it's literally just like one of those games, like you get it, playing it on the 3DS is cool, but like getting an N64 controller in your hand and playing Star Fox 64, like it just, you got the Rumble Pack snapped in there. Like, it just feels awesome. Like, it's so good. I love this game so much. 5 fun factor, 5 vibes.
Oh, for sure.
All day.
We didn't get to like I actually never fully played the 3DS version. That's something I think we'll probably like maybe go back to and like just cover randomly sometime too. So maybe we can get you on the hook to talk about that or something.
Anytime.
Matt, what about you? I you probably didn't play it in prep for this because I just said watch these videos, but.
Yeah, no, and I would have too, I think you can't argue with the 5 out of 5 for vibe, especially like you were saying, the music is just absolutely iconic. It's been in, you know, it's been in Smash, it's been in my brain for 30 years, you know, nearly. It's like, I would say the gameplay for me is probably more, like that 4 out of 5, but maybe that's just because I'm bad at it.
It can be unforgiving in some regards.
It is very sort of that early 3D era sort of it's a little jank, but I don't really try not to hold it against it, but Yeah, I think 4 out of 5 sounds fair from my perspective. But I thought when you brought up the ranking system, Guru, that you were gonna ask us to give the videos a vibe and a gameplay rank.
Well, let's do that real quick then too. Invasion of Nintendo, with the Yoshi's Island and Machine Head at the same time. Actually, I feel like they're all like fives for me in all categories. I don't think I could knock them for anything, really.
I think they're all a 5, but the Star Fox one's like a 5.5. That one is just stands above the other two for me. It's so funny. It's an 11 out of 10. Yeah. It's great.
That one should be nominated for like best short or something at the 97 Oscars or whatever.
The Nintendo Power Awards.
Yes. Why weren't they? Yeah, they should have been patting themselves on the back for that one, for
sure. Yeah, that meme of the guy giving the medal to himself.
McKenna, how about you, Star Fox? Don't let them influence you, you know, too much. Yeah. It feels, you know.
Well, I definitely a 5 for vibes.
For sure.
We talked about it on the episode, but it's got a level of polish that we
compared to some
really
of the other...
compared to a lot of the other games we've played, you know, it's just a step above. It looks good, it sounds good. Mm-hmm. You got these epic cinematic cutscenes. Definitely, yeah. That's an easy 5 for vibes.
For sure.
I feel like I kind of have the same feeling where I'm not very good at it. Like, maybe it could be higher if I got good at it, but I think maybe a 4 for fun factor for now.
I think you could, it's one of those games that it's like, like we said in the video, it almost encourages you to, like, it, like, wants you to die, which is kind of antithetical to what Nintendo wants to happen in a lot of their games. But I think it is, like, I think because I went into it, especially coming off a previous game where it was, like, the first Star Fox, where it was, like, even more reminded me of some of my favorite arcade games, which I've, like, I love Galaga, you know, and I've never, like, gotten past level like 7 of Galaga, you know, so it's like, and it's fine, you know, that's okay. Star Fox though, like, I think because I was like thinking of it in that regard, like, it made it easier to get back up after getting blown up. But yeah, so you're saying like a 4 for fun. Okay, well, well, actually I'll go up and update it later, but I pretty much agree with everything you said, Ryan, and I sort of wanted to add, you were talking about the what was it, the difficulty for me, and having the different paths, like, made it super replayable, and it's one I said it in our episode, but I've played it like just a bajillion times since we started preparing for our episode on it, so I can't give it anything really but a 5 out of 5 for both vibes and fun factor. The only thing I would say is that we said in our episode is that the multiplayer is like fun, but it's sort of like compared to some of the contemporary games like Mario Kart, GoldenEye, it's not as, it doesn't have as many, I guess Mario Kart really actually doesn't have that many bells and whistles on it either, relatively speaking, but it feels like, but with all the items and stuff, there's a little bit more going on. But I would say even if it didn't have the multiplayer, it would be 5 out of 5. Mm-hmm. And then the fact that it just does have like a decently fun multiplayer is like, it's just like a bonus, you know?
The core gameplay of like Mario Kart and GoldenEye are like, you know, better fits for multiplayer, because like, you know, I think Star Fox 64 is like strongest when it is that like behind the, you know, just straightforward rail shooter. Mm-hmm. I think like it kind of loses a little bit in the sense of control when it opens up into like the full 3D space.
I actually like the 3D gameplay in Star Fox 2. the SNES game more than in this. I don't know why. It felt more like, I don't know, like fast-paced and exciting, you know, even though it was like, it was harder to see. It was like a little bit more frame ratey. Yeah. Like this one felt a little bit too like, I don't know. Yeah, it isn't as like compelling in 64. It's really fun, but I guess as a multiplayer thing, it's not as fun. It's more fun doing the dog fights like against Star Wolf, I would say.
Yeah. Yeah. So, but like, I mean, you still can like kind of acclimate to it like after, you know, after a bit. And I feel like at worst, Star Fox 64 feels like the opening level of Shadows of the Empire, and is like pretty awesome. So like that's like as low as it gets.
Sure.
So it's like pretty great. Yeah.
That definitely had the better big like open space battles. You can't deny that for sure. Shadows did, but. And the one other thing too, you mentioned just about the length, I think just the scope too, this is how I feel. Mm-hmm. This is it. It's like the right amount of me for me of difficulty and like the scope of the game. I think about this, if I compare it to Ocarina of Time, it reminds me of Ocarina of Time in so many ways. But one of the ways is that it's like, it's got a big epic story, but it doesn't have like too much, you know, it like straddles for me the perfect line of like gameplay slash like epic story, whereas like, you know, with Ocarina of Time I feel like it does that really well compared to some Zelda games that I like but not as much, where like as they go on it gets kind of more an inflated storyline and like longer stuff, and I'm like, I want to kill some guys, you know. So Star Fox walks that line kind of perfectly, and I think for those big tentpole Nintendo games that we're going to cover on N64, I think a lot of them are like that comparatively to some of their more contemporary counterparts. So I think I'm going to thrive for some of these big Nintendo games for sure. So yeah, perfect five for me. I think it's one of the best games that we've played for the show. Definitely, as McKenna said, like it feels like the most polished. Like I said this on the last actual episode about it, but some of the other games felt more like, you know, they were ported to work at N64, but they weren't really like made for the N64. Mm-hmm. And it feels like Mario 64, Mario Kart 64, and Star Fox 64 have really felt like they are taking advantage of like what's great about the N64, which is not surprising, you know, being like Nintendo's main games they've put out so far.
I'd throw Wave Race into there.
Wave Race. Yeah, for sure. And like even some of the other games we've covered, I've given perfect fives to some of them, but it's like
Doom 64.
Yeah. Even that's
one of
a game.
The best games ever, according to Flashback 64.
I think it is, actually. But
I also agree. It's so good.
But even comparatively, like I might even like playing Doom 64 more than Star Fox at times, but it's like Star Fox is like, just in terms of that level of like that, it's got that shine that like is it's like an it factor type thing. The you know, not everything Nintendo makes is like gold, but you know what I mean? It's got sort of that Nintendo shine to it.
As much as we'd love to stick around here and keep playing with you guys, we gotta go.
Thanks to both of you for coming on. Ryan, thanks for coming back. Thanks for not minding that we just steal your rating system. it is too perfect, so like I like it.
Thank you.
After doing all these, like we do all these videos on Zelda Dungeon and stuff, where we make up convoluted rankings and spreadsheets for all these games, like just for fun, it's like awesome for this to like do that again, but in the like opposite way, where it's like, no, only these two things matter in gaming. So thank you. Is there any what do you want to promote anything? You do any plugs?
I want to promote some games that are at the end of this Star Fox video.
Oh yeah,
there is a montage at the end here. And I remember this being like so like, you know, like this is like keeping me in that N64 ecosystem. Like this is so hype because you have GoldenEye, which looks absolutely incredible here.
Fun fact about that, actually, because I'm in the middle of reading the GoldenEye book, boss fight book, and they talk about this footage because they started off developing it as an on-rails shooter game, and in the book they literally describe this like 5-second clip of the silo level, and I didn't know when I saw that footage, like, what I was like, that's, it looks weird, I can't figure out what's weird about it, and the reason is because it's like at that point it's a rail shooter.
Yeah,
very strange.
Looks so good though.
It does.
Yoshi's Island 64.
Yes, Yoshi's Island 64.
Is that on here? Mischief Makers.
Yes, it just arrived in the mail for me today, by the way. So. Oh,
nice. Yeah. Congratulations. It is a gem.
I love
it. Yeah. International Superstar Soccer 64. A few things to say about that game.
That's coming soon. So you're going to be back on talking about it let that out of the bag. So excited for that one.
And then, again, Zelda 64.
Zelda 64.
Mm-hmm.
In one of those videos, by the way, they spell GoldenEye as two words. GoldenEye. I can't remember which one. I think it was the oldest one. Because maybe, I don't know. I guess GoldenEye was out at that point, though. So, you know, I don't know, just a typo or something. Who knows, but... Okay, so you ought to promote the video, and of course, you have your own stuff, Standard Definition Gaming, great account.
It's a Blue Sky account. Just post old games. It's awesome.
I'm loving the Ocarina of Time and Smash screenshots. Honestly, I love the little screenshots of
25th anniversary of Super Smash Brothers last weekend. Wild.
Shout out to Smash.
Yeah, big shout out to Smash. I occasionally make little PDF zines, but yeah, mostly just run that Blue Sky account, play lots of old games.
Yeah, it's a great account, and it's follow up for all that, because when the zines come out, those are great too. I love those. Matt, thank you for coming on. Thanks for emailing us. That was actually how it started. I haven't even been.
That's right.
I haven't been promoting the email, but it was a great email, and you were a great guest. It was fun to just have someone email and be like, "I'll come on the show," and be like, "Okay, let's do it."
If you don't ask, you know. So no, it was good. I had a great time. I've not done a podcast before. I don't know if that shows or not, but
you're fantastic. Nice. You brought so much to the show. Yeah. I got to say, to everyone, I gush too much, but all our guests we've had have been so great, and they've helped like make our show so much better than it ever could have been. And so, I would definitely include you in that. So do you want to promote anything? I don't even know, what you got going on.
I don't do much. I've got two kids under three, so I just try and stay alive most days.
You want to promote staying alive, being a father?
Yeah, staying alive, raising the next gen, hopefully get them into N64 when they're a little bit older, but for now, not yet.
Okay. Are either of your kids named Turok?
I don't want to dox them, but no.
Okay.
Would you be willing to change their name? We're trying to get something started here. A new revolution.
We'll see. Maybe if there's a number three, maybe we'll see.
Okay, yeah. You could name them Turok 3 Seeds of Evil or whatever. Is that what it's called?
Turok Rage Wars.
What's the middle name? And do we have to change the surname? Oh, that's a whole thing.
Turok Rage Wars, yeah. Okay, so I'm looking ahead. So you can promote your appearance on this podcast, and we'll have to have you on for some more, like, some games proper. I for sure
You've
got to
get me on for the Beatle one.
March.
I have to do some research on that.
HBA? HSV? What was it called? HSV?
Yeah. It even says on the spreadsheet I have HSV Adventure Racing Australia. So I find that so fascinating. We're going to get into that for sure. March.
That is the one thing I know about Australia.
Oh. Yeah, they should talk about that more, I think. They should be more proud of this game. So there's a lot of... it's way too far ahead to say, but there's a lot of racing games in that. It's 1999, so we'll probably have like a fun racing episode. So I've got you on the hook years from now. You'll be doing that at least. hopefully sooner, of course. So.
I'm in. Whenever you want. It worked out really good today, obviously, with the time difference and the fact that I'm not working. But yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm down whenever, you know, shoot me an email.
Oh, yeah. I feel like this is like post podcast conversation, but you know,
yeah, probably
a little peek behind the curtain.
I don't know if you need to sign off first.
Well, it's a good use of the plug segment for sure.
Yeah.
This could be a bonus clip for Patreon.
I'll probably forget and I'll leave it in. So hopefully you haven't said anything you're embarrassed about, but
it's all good.
Do we want to promote anything? We've promoted stuff like in every Star Fox episode we've done. So just. You know, check out all our stuff. it's below. We're on all the website, like all the websites. We have merch and a Patreon, and I don't know. Are you getting a good value out of the Patreon?
Absolutely.
Okay.
The price is very reasonable. I mean, even when you convert it to Australian dollars, it's
$1.
Yeah, it ends up being, I think, two Australian dollars, even though that's not quite the exchange rate. But I'm not complaining. I feel like, you know, I'm getting my money's worth here. Yeah.
Yeah, you get to be on. No, that's not.
Fly your way onto a podcast.
I don't want to promise to people that if they give us a dollar, we'll let you come on the show. No, we do have a Patreon, which right now, like, we just give you a fancy yellow name in Discord. We're still up and coming, so maybe one day we can expand that. But right now it's a humble Patreon. We're a humble podcast. You can email us. We have an email. It's down below. Mm-hmm. All that stuff's down below. Get a hold of us. Mm-hmm. Rate us. And yeah, just keep listening to the show. I guess I don't really have anything else to say. Normally we have a game we're announcing next, but as we've said, our next full episode that's coming out is on... It's a two-pack, and it's on Dark Rift and Tetrasphere. So, that'll be... Yeah, I see your reaction does not...
I do actually have that one on the cartridge, yeah.
Tetrasphere or Dark Rift?
Yeah. Okay. No, Tetrasphere, yeah.
Okay. Well, yeah, we've been playing it, so I'm excited to talk about it, but I don't want to give too much away yet, so... the dark... Hit him with the Dark Rift. Wow.
Sorry, I really just have, like, conveniently placed shelves here.
Yeah, no, it's been incredible.
I think, like, I want to promote your podcast because
thank you.
This has been so, I'm a weekly or monthly listener to the show, and I just personally, like, really enjoy what you're doing.
Thank you.
I think, like, the... you know, the interstitial episodes about other topics of the era, you know, as someone who really just can't stop, like, living in the past, like, you know, your deep dives and perspectives are, like, fantastic. And, you know, it's something I've, you know, I'm telling my friends to listen to.
Oh, thank you.
Like, it truly is, like, a great show that that you both are doing. So thank you for continuing to do it.
Thank you. Yeah, it's so like, fun and exciting to do, like, at each month, you know, like, make our little, like, what's coming next? You know, what's this game? Pulling up, like, Googling what were the hit songs? You know, it's just like,
yeah,
I don't know. It's just, like, it's fun because it gives, like, we do plenty of things that have nothing to do with N64, but it is, I won't lie, it's kind of fun to be like, oh boy, we get to watch, like, a random movie, you know, like, I don't know, there's something,
movie.
A volcano, oh, yeah, I don't know, it's exciting, so, yeah, thanks both of you for coming on the show, looking forward to having you back, thanks to everyone for listening, we'll see everybody, in like a couple weeks. I don't know when this is coming out. We'll see you at Dark Rift and Tetrasphere.
You see at the corner.